Okay, so
I think we're doing Dave, good now.
Dave will give Dave the rundown. Dave sure. always gives of how okay. it works.
Thank you, Veronica.
We're very informal.
I'll give Dave the rundown. Yeah, it's all blasé, fireside chat sort of deal. Pretty much how it all works out is 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1.
One.
Hello world is a song that we're singing. Come on, get happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames, messieurs, bienvenue, welcome to the Habby Hour.
Hey guys, welcome back to the podcast. Thanks for joining us. My name is David OJ and I'm at MetalDave02 on Twitter.com, joined as always by Veronica.
Yeah, I'm at CHILE underscore Pepper on Twitter.
And that's it, aside from our guest. Unfortunately, Beth is unable to join us tonight. And we are the Habby Hour, at Habby Hour on Twitter, Habby Hour Pod on Instagram, and YouTube / Habby Hour. Thank you for 200 subscribers on YouTube.
Yes!
You know, click that like button and click that subscribe button, influencers and such. So we actually...
We're not on Facebook.
We're not on Facebook. No, absolutely not. Jesus. Just, it's the worst. We have a guest with us tonight, and I have an intro that I did not write for him. Our guest is a Montreal-based journalist and radio host who can be heard on CJAD 800. He got his start in radio on Team 990, then TSN 690. He has appeared on CTV News Channel, Canada AM, and Sky TV, Talk Sport and Talk Radio in the UK, and has written for the National Post, Montreal Gazette, Toronto Sun, and more. Wow. While more known for his love of the Expos, our guest has enjoyed a lifelong love affair with the Habs and has many fond memories of going to the Forum, including the 93 Cup-winning game, the 93 All-Star game, Patrick Waugh's last game. Wow. And the last game at the Forum. It's my absolute pleasure to welcome Dave Kaufman. Dave, how are we doing?
I'm great. Thanks for having me, guys.
Great.
So awesome. Lucky.
So lucky. That is a lot of history and an impressive resume. Really great stuff.
It makes it sound, it's funny because when I hear it out loud now, it makes it sound like everything stopped after March of 1996. But are some fun and fine memories from the Bell Center as well. I can recall a double overtime playoff game and looking at my friend going, why the hell is Bill Lindsay taking this face off? And then the game was over. But there's a lot in there from the Bell Center years. It just doesn't seem to compare. And I don't. Were either of you lucky enough to go to the Forum?
Veronica, I was not.
You were. Okay, Veronica was. Okay. It was a special place, and I feel very fortunate that I can still close my eyes and do a virtual tour. There's something really special about that building, and it's unfortunate that the success of the team is so tied to that. And I was, of course, last week was the 25th anniversary of the last game at the Forum, and there were all kind of retrospectives, and a lot of journalists wrote pieces or did TV pieces on it. And one of the things that was mentioned, which made me chuckle, was that there was a parade that was to bring the banners from Atwater to Drummond Street.
Wow.
And to allegedly allow the ghosts to move to the new building. And it seems as if the ghosts made a left at Guy or something and never made it to the what was then the Molson Center and now the Bell Center.
I wonder where they are now.
Yeah, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dave and I, just before the pandemic, Beth and Dave and I made a pilgrimage out to Montreal, and we were at actually the last Habs game on a Saturday night in Montreal before the pandemic. And
I remember seeing photos of you in town.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we went to the old Forum, and we just, the three of us together, we were just like, standing and staring in silence at the little, you know, the little museum that they have on the upper level there, and just soaked every moment of it in. And it's so like, it's so obviously it's so different now. It's so hard to imagine. Like, it's just so, anyway, I always remember from when I was little,
are you
escalators. Pardon?
Of course, yeah. No, I remember the escalators too. I it's funny. I remember the rush of people. I was 12 years old when we won the cup, and my dad came home that the day before and said, "We have tickets to the game." His best friend gave him tickets for what was Game 5 of the 1993 Cup Finals, and just an incredible experience. But I have these vivid memories of the game being over. And us being stuck on the escalator trying to leave with pandemonium outside on St. Catherine Street, and it wasn't moving. And this was the same year as, I guess it was the 75th anniversary of the NHL? Does that ring a bell?
I don't
remember. I know it was the 100th anniversary of the Stanley Cup, but I think it was the 75th anniversary of the NHL. I can picture logos and this giant banner that hung on St. Catherine Street along with the escalators, and these two dudes in front of us on the escalator stood up on the side rail and just yanked it down, rolled it up, and they were off.
Oh my God.
That's awesome. I just did a quick Google on that. It seems like the 75th season was the 91-92 season. So it might've been a year off, but it would make sense if there's a banner.
So it must've been
the 100th of the Stanley Cup.
I mean, definitely the 100th year of the Cup. Yeah, 100th year of Stanley Cup then, for sure.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I can picture the logo that was on the crest of the jerseys that year, which I think was the same.
Right, right.
Incredible.
So there you go. 5 minutes in, I've already screwed something up. No. I think I have a fact checker,
Oh,
Dave.
My God. That's what we do here.
You have no idea.
You have no idea.
I will cite tweets and just have like no recollection of who tweeted it ever. And I always say with the standard, like, sir or madam, if you tweeted this, let me know and I'll give you credit. But it happens so often. So don't worry about the fact checks here. I just did it. But
I'll try and be as accurate as possible. Mm-hmm. I'll do my best to be as accurate as possible.
Yeah, all good. So today happens to be, you know, a kind of special day in Habs history because it's actually the 25th birthday of the Molson Center or the Bell Center opening up. That's today, 25 years ago. And also, I think it was the anniversary on March 6th then, the last game at the Forum, or at least when the Forum closed down. So March has some really...
March 11th was the last game at the Forum.
Okay.
March 11th, 1996.
There
it
is.
And then there was... So today was... I guess the anniversary of the toughest ticket in Montreal Canadiens history.
Ooh.
Because if you weren't a sponsor or a season ticket holder, you were not getting into the Molson Center that night.
Oh,
I remember trying to pull every string I could, but every ticket was gone. It was just an impossibility. And that was my recollections were that it meant to, like, it was a big deal that I got tickets to the second game at the Molson Center. But there was no getting in there for the first.
And tell us, so you were in the building for that. I was watching it on TV, the ovation for the rocket, and just tears streaming down my face and seeing all of the emotion of everybody that just got louder and louder and louder. And how long was it? It was like several minutes long. Like, what was that feeling like to be there?
Yeah. I think it was 8 or 9 minutes long, and the fact that I still remember it so vividly, I think speaks to its the magnitude of what I had witnessed. Before the game started, they brought out Lafleur, Béliveau, and Brichard to drop the puck. And just from that moment on, you knew that it was just a different level. It was going to be something so special that night, and I'll encourage your viewers and listeners to check out my Twitter feed at The Kaufman Show. I tweeted out a bunch of photos that I took at the game. I somehow at 15 years old had the presence of mind to bring a camera Wish I'd thought of that at 12 for the cup win. But I got some amazing photos on that show you. I started taking pictures before the game even started, and you can see an empty Forum, which is an incredible shot. It was just so special to be there, and it was everybody in there knew that they were very lucky. I think that was the takeaway from that is that it was just such a fortunate thing to be able to do that. My ticket was $12, guys. It was a standing room ticket. And I took the afternoon off school with a couple of friends, and we went down to the forum and we sat and we waited so that we could get a good spot. And we ended up center right in the Reds. You went in and you had to book it up a flight of stairs and run. And I'm telling you, when I close my eyes, I can still picture the run and where I had to go and passing all of the old photos of the different teams and the everything about that building was just so special. And I spent my childhood outside waiting for autographs, sneaking into practices. I got to skate there one day, which was an incredible moment that I'll never forget. I liken that to, you know, if someone told me they got to play a pickup ball game at Fenway Park or something. I think it's on the same, in the same lines of that, you know, got to throw around a football at Lambeau. And I'm very aware that those who've come after me, the people who love the Habs and didn't get to have that, they're missing out. And in the same way that the generations before me always used to tell me that the golden age was go when whether you grew up and saw the Habs in the 50s or the dynasty in the 70s, that was never coming back. And even though I didn't have that, and you could argue about the flukiness of the cups that we've won in my lifetime, I feel so fortunate to have that. And it's such a huge part of my growing up and being a proud Montrealer.
Amazing. Awesome. That is amazing. Wow. I'm trying to think with the Bell Center there, have you ever had time to skate at the Bell Center, for instance? I know they opened it up like it's not like too much of a hot ticket to get into the Bell Center to skate there. But, you know, what about the Bell Center now? Could you draw a comparison, actually, between the Forum and the Bell Center? I know it's a hard one, but what would you think?
If I was, there have been a couple of moments through the years where the Bell Center has felt that almost as if the ghost did make it for a few brief fleeting moments. One that I was there for would be, I think it was Mario Lemieux's last game.
Ooh,
and wow. Not his last game ever, but his last game in Montreal, playing for the Penguins. And, I have memories of him, and again, we need our fact checker here, but I have memories of him scoring either a goal or two goals in the third period, and the place just erupting.
Wow.
Another, I think probably the biggest moment in Bell Center or Molson Center history to do with the Canadiens has to be when Sakou came back, right?
Oh, I mean, yes.
I don't know if there's another moment that equals that. I think that's, correct me if I'm wrong, and you guys are probably the experts on this, but that's the most important moment of the last 25 years for the Montreal Canadiens, right?
I would agree.
And I can't come up with anything else off the top of my head.
Were you there for that too? For Sakou?
No, I was in London, Ontario. I was at university.
Oh.
And wishing that I was in Montreal. It was at the time I was living with seven people, all of them from Toronto. Ooh. And I remember we used to hang out, and this was when the Leafs were good. They were like perennially competitive, the Sundin Leafs.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember feeling such pride that day, and the whole room was. We'd all sit around and watch these games, and usually I'd get razzed for being a Habs fan. But in that moment, I think everybody realized how big a moment that was. And Sakou Koivu is the last hockey player to have that kind of a hold on me, like the players did when I was a kid, like Patrick Waugh did when I was young, or, you know, going back, Russ Courtnell when I first fell in love with hockey. Yeah. And it hasn't really, I haven't felt that feeling. I don't know if it's age or being jaded or moving away from sports journalism. But when Koivu came back in that moment, it just felt so important. And in many ways, what Sakou Koivu went through was the last time that I really, literally, and figuratively lived and died with the Montreal Canadiens, where it just felt larger than life. And sometimes, Veronica, I see your tweet and I think, I wish I still had that passion that you have day in, day out. I'm in many ways, I'm very envious of it. But I don't know how to capture it. I don't know how to take it back.
And I think that, do you know Laura Sapa?
We've met.
So I love her. She's got a podcast, Last on Canadien, with Scott Matla. But that was her first game at the Bell Centre, Sacco's return.
The Koivu game?
Yeah. Oh
God.
Wow.
Isn't that incredible?
Wow.
And that's when the hook got in there. Man.
All downhill from there, right?
Yeah, like, geez. No, you talk about the passion for the team, and I just don't know any other way to be about them. Like, PK Subban is, like, I was his number one fan. 2 days after he was gone, I was over him. I was all about Shea Weber, you know, and it's, for me, it's the
one
team.
One of few, Veronica.
I beg your pardon?
I said one of few people that one just said, you know, dropped him like a, you know, bag of garbage.
And people get furious about that and still talk about that day. But
to this day.
I hated that day. That day was awful.
It was awful. Two days later, I was fine.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Well, then you subscribe to the Jerry Seinfeld rule about sports, and you don't get associated with the individual. Seinfeld, I'm paraphrasing it, but it's something like when you cheer for a team, you're cheering for laundry. And I think good for you that you can do that. That's a nice trait.
Yeah.
I don't have that. I will not make this a baseball conversation, but I'll just tell you that when Delino DeShields was traded for Pedro Martinez, I sobbed. It was the end of the world for me. And every time Lino came back to the Big O, I was so excited to see him and felt like he was born to play baseball in Montreal. And in many ways, I felt that something similar about PK. Mm-hmm. It reminded me that this is a business, and the Montreal Canadiens are not here for loyalty. They're here for the laundry. And luckily we have the most beautiful laundry in sports.
Yeah,
it is. Yeah. I won't argue that. Depending on what color they're wearing on a certain night, at least in particular this season, Lord.
Yeah, not the blues, not the blues.
It's so crazy that they haven't been like the games that they even play in them aren't that good. Either they have an off night and maybe it's in their heads, but my word, those retro jerseys. And people have been barking about a third jersey for years. This is what we get.
I just find it strange. I can't remember who they were playing last when they wore the blues, but I kept getting them confused with whoever they were playing.
Was it Winnipeg?
Does that ring a bell?
I think it was Winnipeg.
It might have been. Yeah. I think it was a Saturday night. And they were wearing the blues, and it just didn't make sense to me. And I kept, would it be fair to say that it's kind of like if you turned on the TV on a Saturday night, the Toronto Maple Leafs were wearing red?
Yeah, I guess so.
It is a bit jarring. I guess their whole shtick with that particular color blue was that was the blue color that the 70 dynasty wore, the 70s dynasty. Apparently that particular blue was it. So
that shade.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And at least that's the reason they give.
Doesn't do it for me.
That means it's retro.
If you're going to do the third jersey and you want to wear an old school jersey, do the one with the laces on the jersey and the dip over here.
There we go.
Mm-hmm. I like that. I like that. That'll give it that 70s feel. Tell them they can't wear the chest protector, the neck guard, have the tufts of hair flying out.
Absolutely.
Smoking on the bench.
I think I'm trying to think. There was a recent Habs jersey that did have laces. I wonder if it was like the 2015 jerseys. Not that I'm a jersey aficionado by any stretch of the imagination, but I definitely have a Habs jersey. I think it's a Pacioretty jersey that has laces. And that was like the season's jersey, you know what I mean? So interesting.
It wasn't one of the 100th anniversary jerseys?
No, I don't think so. Nope.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I did get a
that was another business. Actually, now that I'm jogging my brain, that the 100th anniversary game was another really special moment at the Bell Center.
Yep.
When Gordie Howe was there and spoke to the crowd, and they took that picture with all the alumni who did the warm up around the ice. Really cool moment.
Mm-hmm. I have one of the not diorama, just one of those huge pictures of that particular shot. I'm trying to think, like, Georges Laroque was on the current roster at the time. I think Josh Georges as well. You know, some of those folks. Patches was a young guy. Gianta was there. And then, yeah, of course, the alumni from years past.
Wow.
What a great time.
Dave, I have a question for you.
Sure.
On the night that Jean Béliveau passed, was that you I was listening to on CJAD? Yeah.
Yeah. I was on my sister's couch. It was probably about midnight.
Yeah.
And the news came down that Béliveau had passed. There was a snowstorm in Montreal. And I got in my car and drove to CJAD behind a snowplow.
Wow.
And just commandeered the mic and did at least an hour, probably 2 hours of radio that night. I remember DMing Strombo and asking him to come on the show and not thinking about the politics behind that of him working for our competitor at the time. Because of that, the audio was never posted the next day.
Oh.
But at least for that part. But that's okay. Radio is about being in the moment. And it felt like an important moment that there should be live radio. I'm pretty sure we might have to ask him, but I'm pretty sure either Matthew Ross or Mo Khan did the same thing down the hall and just got in and went on air on TSN. And between the two of us, we had wall-to-wall coverage that night.
Yeah. I was listening to you that night. Actually, when I tuned in, you were talking to Andrew Berkshire. And and just all of the callers that night, everybody has a story, such a touching story about what a gentleman and what a just wonderful, wonderful person he was. I've never heard a bad word spoken about him.
No, it's from a different era.
Yeah.
To a fault, everybody loved Jean Béliveau. It was important to pay tribute to the man and then to be able to go to the Bell Center and give my condolences to his family for what was another one. See, they're coming back. It's not just the old forum. That the couple of days at the Bell Center where everything was cast in this black and the awards were there and the family stood. It was the largest wake I've ever seen or the largest receiving line I'd ever seen. And just an incredible, incredible moment. There was something similar when Rocket Richard passed away. I remember there being, it was in May of, I think, 2000. And there was, somewhere like to sign a book and go out. It was outside of the Bell Center and I had been out of town and flew in and landed at Dorval, now Trudeau, and went straight to the Bell Center to sign the guest book after Maurice Richard died. I had a next door neighbor who I think we'll probably talk about who played with Richard. And, I wanted to sign the book on behalf of my old neighbor, Mr. Getliff, who, is actually credited with giving Maurice Richard his nickname Rocket. So this was one of my earliest introductions to hockey was through this neighbor of mine who lived behind our house. So at night, my dad used to joke that he would wash the dishes looking out the kitchen window and staring at him would be Mr. Getliff washing his dishes and looking out the kitchen window and they'd wave. And when he passed away, which was in the mid 2000s, he was the oldest living Montreal Canadian.
Wow.
He played for 5 years. He played with the Bruins from 35 to 40 and then played with the Habs from 40 to 45. And used to come out and play hockey with us kids and gave me a bunch of hockey memorabilia. Veronica, I sent you a photo last night of a program that he gave me from Chicago Stadium, which had an article on him as the brand new Bear Cub. He was a rookie in 1935 with the Bruins, and they wrote a piece on him as someone to watch when watching the game at Chicago Stadium. That.
And then he wears the number 16. Was that the last line in that?
Yeah, yeah. It was exactly. In fact, I own a Boston Bruins sweatshirt that he gave me that I have never worn and that I will never throw out. No. Because it's you know, and yet here I am on a Habs podcast saying that I own a piece of Bruins clothing.
No,
but it's from Mr.
Totally
Gatliff,
so that it'll, memorabilia.
But yeah, he was just a lovely man, and learning along the way that not only did he is he a footnote in Montreal Canadiens history, but that he nicknamed Maurice Richard the Rocket. And the story is that he watched Richard bowl someone over in practice and skate right through him and said, wow, when he went through whoever it was, his eyes lit up like a rocket. And Dick Carroll from the Montreal Gazette, who was the sports writer at the time for the Gazette, overheard him and started to use that as Rocket Richard from there on out. So really cool. And of course, you know, in his own right, he was a great hockey player. He was a third liner. He scored 5 goals in one game. Turns out that was a game where he was taken off the third line and he was put on a line with Elmer Locke. And after Mr. Getliff died, his son told the Canadian press that he said that he could have scored, I think he said something like he could have scored 70 goals a year using only a broom if he had gotten to play every day with Elmer Locke.
Yeah. those stories. I've had shivers 5 times already since we started talking.
Oh, good.
Yeah. I have a story for you. Remember how I told you? So I have a friend who was a work colleague of mine, and we're still friends. We're still in touch. But he is a Montrealer, born and bred. He's working in Toronto now, but he's so hilarious. His name is Marc Dupont, and I had like he's just such a goofball and so normal. I had no idea that he came from a family, and so I was telling him
like the rest
that
of
I
us?
Was listening. Pardon me?
Said like the rest of us?
No, he comes from a family.
Okay,
I did not know. I was telling him, actually, we were talking about, because it was right after Monsieur Béliveau had passed. And so we were talking about it the next day, because he's not a huge Montreal Canadiens fan, but he loves to talk about things. So he came to talk about this with me. And I told him that I was listening to you on CJAD. And he said, oh, yeah, that station is named after my grandfather. Charles James Arthur DuPont.
Yeah.
I'm like, wow. Who are you? What? It's just so nuts. Like, oh yeah, yeah.
That's really cool.
And he played that kind of stuff had never come up in conversation.
You can tell your friend that I not too long ago, I like to go walking in the Notre Dame de Neige Cemetery.
Mm.
It's just this incredible, beautiful historical place that's in Côte des Neiges, and in fact Rocket Richard's grave is there, and it's this beautiful, beautiful gravesite. But you can tell your friend that I passed Arthur DuPont's grave not too long ago, and I was like, hey, that's so cool. So yeah, that's wow, talk about Montreal history. That's really neat. And the station just celebrated their 75th anniversary in December. Such a legacy. I mean, it was when I first got the opportunity to be on air, all I could think was this was the station that was on 24 hours a day in my grandparents' kitchen.
Crazy.
So yeah, pretty cool.
I always think about that because that's the kind of thing that he would never drop, you know, into a conversation unless it was extremely topical. And he just acted like, oh, yeah, nothing.
Anyway. Definitely worth checking out Rocket Richard's gravesite when you come back to Montreal.
I definitely will.
It's absolutely beautiful. Has a Habs logo. It has sculptures of his face. I believe there's an engraving of the torch. It says "Never Give Up" underneath it with his autograph. Mm. It's really, really special.
That's something.
Did you meet him ever, Dave?
Yeah. Yeah. A few times. I was such a lucky kid. Honest to goodness. I really, really was. I remember once meeting him. There was a restaurant called Le Biftec. It was a steakhouse. And we were walking through and he walked by and I can't remember. I was with both my parents and my sister and I can't remember if it was my mom or my dad, but one of them like grabbed my hand extra tight and they were like, "Do you know who just walked by?" And, you know, I very, you know, just like a little kid, "Monsieur Richard, est-ce que je peux avoir ton autographe?" And he pulls a card out of his jacket and signs an autograph for me. And
ready to go.
It turns out that my great uncle worked with him at it was a company called S. Albert. They did home oil. So if you needed oil to heat your house in the wintertime, this was the company that did it. And that was, I don't know if it was his first job post-hockey, but it was something he did post-hockey. And I have somewhere, I could dig it out, but I have a couple of autographs where he full named me to David Kaufman.
Oh, wow.
All the best wishes, Maurice Rocket Richard. Yeah. So that's always meant a lot. I have a pile. I was an autograph hound when I was a kid and kept most of them and have a lot of them in pretty good shape too. But that's one that probably should go up on a wall now that I think about it. I look around. I could probably make room for that.
Yeah.
That's
put
awesome.
It in the middle of a big frame.
Yeah. Huge frame.
Yeah. That was
just that.
Right. Right. But no, I mean, I got to meet most of those guys when I was a kid. The 93 All-Star game was, in fact, where I met just about every hockey player who existed. It was to be 12 years old and at the All-Star game. What a dream that was. I mean, I within a span of a few hours meeting Gordie Howe and Timu Solani and Jaromir Jagr. And actually maybe Solani was the next year. I remember meeting Solani before a Jets game in Montreal, but Bure and surreal to watch Pavel Bure, but also as a Hab to see Valerie Bury walking into the mold to the forum with Candace Cameron at the time. That was,
I was trying to remember her name.
DJ Tanner.
exactly.
I remember standing, there was an entrance where the players would come in. It was like a media entrance as well. And I was on the inside at that point and I was getting Gil Stein's autograph, who was the commissioner of the NHL at the time. Wow. And I could see Wayne Gretzky walking in out of the corner of my eye. And it was just like, Mr. Commissioner, sir, can we please make this quick? Because it's Wayne Gretzky over there.
Oh, that's a good one.
Hurry up. You know what? And it's funny. Exactly. I remember meeting Dick Irvin that weekend.
That's incredible.
And him saying to me, "Do you realize how lucky you are to be here, that you were able to get a ticket, that your parents let you go, that they were able to afford to allow you to be here right now?" And he kind of knocked some sense into me and allowed me to realize that this wasn't something that happens every day. And to try and bottle those memories in a way that I might not have had he not sort of read me the riot act.
It was just his birthday, wasn't it?
It was, and he just got the vaccine as well. I think Dave Stubbs was
That's
tweeting
good
that.
News. He's in his 90s.
That he just got the vaccine, and it was done at the Bill Dernan Arena, which is the goalie who had a very short but illustrious career. I think he only played 7 seasons for the Habs, but won the Vezina 6 times. He was an ambidextrous goaltender.
Oh my God.
And I believe it was Stubbs who was pointing out that it was very cool that Dick Irvin Jr. was getting the shot at an arena named after someone who had played for Dick Irvin Sr.
Yeah.
That is pretty
cool.
Wow,
it's just so much rich history there.
Have you ever met up with Dave at any point? Dave Stubbs, that is.
You know what? I don't think we've ever met. I have interviewed him a number of times, but I don't think I've ever met Dave face to face. No.
So Veronica's the only
one.
But
I love that the NHL was like, let's create a job for this guy.
Oh yeah.
Because he's just such a treasure trove of knowledge of the history of the game. And I think that's really important. And I think I don't know this for sure, but I get the feeling he can flex those muscles more than he could have for the Gazette. So it's to the benefit of everyone that he gets to do that. And maybe the next step is to be the official historian of the NHL. I don't know if that's a position that they have. I know in Major League Baseball, John Thorne has that position. And if you ever watch any of the Ken Burns baseball stuff, they always talk to John. He's an incredible follow on Twitter as well for history and for the history of baseball. But I liken Dave to the Montreal or Canadian equivalent of that.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. For sure. Yeah. Veronica, I think, is the only person, at least among us here on the podcast presently, that's actually had a lunch with Mr. Stubbs. How fancy.
Nice.
How it was posh. A coffee, actually, ended up lasting like an hour and a half.
Great coffee.
Isn't that nice? He was in Vancouver at a time when he was still covering the team. Oh God, it would have been around 2011 maybe. And we followed each other on Twitter, and he sent me a note, and he said, I have time for a cup of coffee today if you can come join me. I'm like, yes.
Okay. Yeah.
And then he told me stories about going to the Bellevaux's house and having meals with them and having tea and just like, and you can tell that the mystique hasn't left for Dave Stubbs.
No.
Like he can't find my words right now, but he becomes like very emotional when he's telling these stories. You know, he knew these people. And so these players and has been around the team, and he has a huge respect for them.
As a fan, moments like that are great, because you kind of just shut up and listen and soak it all in. And you know, you can't always be in the room, but how cool is it to get to talk to someone who was?
Yeah.
And that's, I've had a lot of opportunities to talk to people who have been in those rooms and seen those things. And my brain is always just like, shut up, Kaufman, just shut up, just take this all in, because who knows when you're going to get an opportunity like this again.
Mm-hmm. I know that whenever we do have Mr. Stubbs on, it's a pretty easy podcast. He usually, we ask him one question and that's the hour. We got it. But he is so good. And he's so great free with his time too. And he's an incredible, incredible person, be it, you know, talking hockey or just, you know, shooting whatever it is about the team. He's just, he's a fantastic guy. So I at least wanted to mention that about him. He's great.
Last time we had him on was right after Henri Richard had passed. And that was.
So that was around this time last year, right? It was just before the lockdown last year.
Yes,
because the
that's
funeral
right.
was canceled.
Yeah.
The funeral was they said that it would be a private ceremony because of the coronavirus.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I guess
that
would be
really thrown a wrench into everything.
Yeah, yeah. I was about to say, for listeners, I think this is like the first year of our pandemic season, I guess. Because remember, at least for the podcast, because when that happened, NHL shuts down. And then, you know, us here are thinking, what are we going to talk about for a while? And it was all coronavirus stuff, unfortunately. So, but I mean, it kind of...
Trump.
Yeah, and that. And just, ugh. So it seems like, you know, we're starting to finally actually round the corner when it comes to
we're in year two of the pandemic podcast now.
Yeah, essentially. But things are on the uptick, I think. So vaccines are getting out there. Get shots in people's arms. That's the new...
Let's hope so. It. Yeah. From your lips to God's ears, man. Absolutely. That's everything. And it's great. I know you're in New York State, mm-hmm. Dave, and it's nice to finally see America doing a little bit better. And yeah. I know I speak because Veronica, your tweets are, well, solidarity, sister. I think you and I are very similar in our passion for democracy and and our hatred of fascism. And it has been nice to have that solidarity with someone on the other side of the country. So to know that when you do tweet about things that are news or political, they resonate with me. Maybe more than when you're trash talking Leafs fans. Marginally.
Yeah. Actually, trying to think what's worse, the blowback from political tweets or the blowback from Leafs tweets. And I'm not sure which is worse, Veronica.
I do. Looking at my follower count is not something that I normally do, but and I actually it's something that I never do. But I recently noticed I had a bunch of new followers who used to follow me, and I at some point apparently had unfollowed me, and it was probably during the whole Trump stuff because I got DMs from people saying, "I'm unfollowing you because of this. That's not why I follow you." I'm like, okay, then unfollow me because I come by this, honestly, I come from a country that lost its democracy for 17 years. So this is like, I grew up in a house of anti-fascism and activism. And we had a picture of the president on our wall, the fallen president. And so I feel very passionate about it. And I was saying this about that guy ever since he was running. I'm like, this is what he's going to do. And don't even think that he's ever going to behave like a president. Anyway, sorry, tangent.
No, important and completely true. Ever since he went down that goddamn escalator, man, oh man, I was like, this is a problem. It's a problem.
Anyway.
But yeah, everything's all good now. No problems whatsoever south of the border.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's right. It totally, everything, perfect. All the problems went away.
We got it covered.
All the problems went away.
Everyone's getting their Biden bucks. But it is nice to see. We're okay.
Well, and everyone's at least getting at the vaccine, and that will allow us to return to normal. I mean, how strange is it to watch hockey now and have the pumped in crowd sound and these empty arenas? It is the strangest, most surreal thing. And they didn't even do what all the other sports have done. And pretend to have fans and do, I mean, if I tilt my camera over here and you look into the corner, you can see the cardboard cutout of my nephew and myself from the that sat on the left field line in Buffalo this year to watch the Blue Jays.
For just a second, I thought it was a real child. And I was thinking, oh, my God, what is that poor child doing? I mean, he's just... Like, I thought he was, like, huddled, like...
If you leak, I'm
behind the plant.
That's it. That's... Oh, no, the poor child. Veronica, call social services. But it's absolutely crazy.
Speaking of the jab in the arm, how is that rollout going in Quebec? Because I, Megan really McCain, well. Co-host of The View, don't know when I'm going to get the shot. It's going to be something like September.
Oh, my God. I can't believe
I'm happy to wait,
that.
But it seems like it's rolling out a lot better. What, did you miss your second shot, Dave?
No. Just what Megan said on The View. I'll be like, I'm a blah, 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 blah. And I don't know when I'm going to get the shot. It's like, come on. Really? Come on.
Hi, Megan McCain, co-host of The View. Like,
daughter of Senator McCain. It's like, we know.
We know.
My next shot's coming on Friday. That's my second shot. And I expect to be out of commission Saturday. Yes. Go ahead.
That's amazing. No, that's wonderful. I mean, you should be screaming from the housetops. That's incredible.
I was going to say.
So 2 weeks from Friday, it's the Roaring Twenties again.
That's right.
Albany's going to turn into a den of iniquity.
Yeah. It's either that, or I was speaking to my mom about it. I'm like, Mom, I'm going to get a flight to Vegas and just start licking doorknobs. We're going to have a party. Let's go.
Your mom's had hers. Hey, Dave.
No. No, I don't think she's actually eligible yet. I'm eligible, and it's not a red light, but I have a comorbidity because of my white blood cell issue that I have. It's not a problem. I don't have anything jarring wrong, but I'm a patient at New York's oncology and hematology. They sent me an email and said, "Hey, you're on the list. Go get your shot." And I said, "Oh." And at first I was like, you know, I felt guilty because I was like, you know, I'm pretty healthy, and I have when it comes to pandemic stuff, I can work from home. I have no issues with that. And thank God, you know, one of my friends said, Dave, you know, if you can get the shot, get it, because herd immunity and everything and this, that, and the other thing, just do it. I said, okay, fine. I guess I will. So got my first shot, 3 weeks ago. And then this Friday, going to be driving on over to Syracuse to the state fairgrounds to get my second jab. So there it is.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank
you. It's so such to a, answer your question, Veronica.
Yeah.
To answer your question, the vaccine rollout is actually going pretty well. Quebec took a gamble before anybody else in North America and said, we'd rather get one jab into everybody than get two jabs into fewer people. And as it turns out, a broken clock is right twice a day, and Quebec actually lucked into something here. My dad got his vaccine, his first shot, last Tuesday. The premier announced today in a press conference that any Quebecer who wants a shot will have it by Saint Jean Baptiste Day, by June 24th. So if that's true, then I mean, who knows? There might actually be an Oceaga this summer.
Yeah, and that would be a big deal.
And Quebec has really,
there would,
really
a lot of things. Pandemic. It's been hard. It's been really hard, and this has been an extremely difficult year. And I don't think we're alone in that. I think that there are a lot of places around the world that have had a really hard time, and compared to what we've seen in the States, it's been pretty good, but I don't think that has to be our benchmark.
Yeah.
I don't think the bar needs to be so low. Put a giant spotlight once again on how we treat old people in our society. Mm-hmm. Will we learn that lesson and do a better job in respecting our elders and seniors from here on out? Only time will tell, but seeing the isolation, the loneliness that so many seniors who only can now really go out and live again, it's just awful. And in many ways, I was not one who wanted hockey to come back last year. I thought it was absolutely trivial to have sports being played while we were dealing with what we were dealing with as a society. I was wrong. The joy that Montrealers had from that victory, that 5-game series with Pittsburgh, actually, I think it raised a lot of spirits and was a really nice moment for the city that needed a nice moment. Maybe if we were more used to winning, winning a play-in series at the end of the playoffs might not have had the same oomph. But at the time, I can remember I guess it was the last game, and just, I was in Old Montreal at the time having dinner, and the whole city, it seemed to erupt. Obviously a much more low-key version. There weren't any cop cars on fire, yeah. But it was a nice moment nonetheless.
That's what Dave Auger says all the time. When he goes back to Montreal, he's going to burn up the cop cars and throw the benches into the river, and it's just going to be a whole party.
It's going to be a catastrophe. Now, next time the Habs win the Cup, I always say that it's going to be a party. Just you wait. I look forward to it, but I also fear it because I know it's going to be pandemonium, just absolute anarchy.
So the one thing I don't want is I don't want that now. Right. I don't want, you know, after the start that the Habs had, mm-hmm. when everybody was like, oh my God, we've been waiting forever and this is the team and they're going to be better than the Leafs and this is the year we win the Cup. I kept thinking, no, this is not, we don't want the year to win the Cup be the year that we can't go to bars.
Yes.
Right.
Let Toronto win it this year. Come on.
You know, imagine.
Let Toronto finally win their Cup on Absolutely a year where not. they can't enjoy it.
I can get behind
I won't
that.
Allow it. No, the next Canadian team to win has to be Montreal, period, the end.
Period, the end, period, underscore.
Yeah.
Large text.
I couldn't take it if Toronto won the Cup. I would not be able to take it.
In color.
Why not?
Why not?
Yeah, why not?
Because it would be painful.
Why not?
It would be painful.
But... see, I don't buy into the pan-Canadian nationalism. I'm not a nationalist.
No.
And it bothers me that you're supposed to cheer, that there's this sort of unwritten rule that we see that you're supposed to cheer for the Canadian team. I've never understood that.
No.
Like, I'm with you. I like the idea that the Habs are the last team to win the Cup from Canada. And I'd, of course, like them to be the next team to win the Cup from Canada. But... I don't know, man. I've got enough friends in Toronto and people that I care about that I know how much joy it would bring them.
Yeah. You know,
I remember being that. I remember being that 12-year-old kid and having that feeling and how wonderful it was and just assuming. Like I'll tell you, I had my grade 6 graduation. Like that even matters one iota. But we had our grade 6 graduation the week after we won the Cup. Mm. And I couldn't go to the parade. And the whole time I was like, oh, you know what? I'll get to the next parade. Because there's going to be another parade. Oh. We've never gone more than 6 years without winning a Cup. So I'm still waiting for that parade. And when it happens, I will be as excited as I was when I was 12 years old. But I wish that feeling on others. I don't... there isn't that hatred. And that's, I think, the difference between maybe what you see in Europe with football teams, with Chelsea and Arsenal, where they'll come to blows. I've never seen that. I remember heated moments at the Forum when I was a kid where I remember getting a bunch of beer poured on me by Rangers fans. And this was back, you know, when you'd yell stuff like 1940, because they hadn't won since then at that point. But afterwards, it was all hugs and smiles and handshakes and let me buy you a beer. And that's where it's supposed to be. Every once in a blue moon, you'll see a fight at the Bell Centre. And you kind of know in your bones that it's just alcohol related, because it doesn't normally get to that point. It's not like we have segregated sessions where the Leafs fans are on the east side of the building and the Habs fans are on the west side of the building. We all live and exist together. And my hatred for Toronto doesn't run that deep, whether it's the hockey team or the city. And frankly, in my lifetime, in our lifetimes, there's much more to hate about the Bruins or the Flyers than there is about the Maple Leafs.
Well, I think that you're very generous of spirit. My dark, evil heart can't go there. Can't. And it's not about Toronto, because I was able to cheer for the Raptors. Guys.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was able to cheer for the Raptors. But I can't. It's not even a Toronto thing. And I know people who live in Toronto as well, who are fantastic people. I even follow a Leafs fan or two, but it's, and especially I think with the advent of Twitter, it's made it worse.
I would never punch
anybody.
Twitter makes everything worse, let's be honest. I mean, it's, Twitter is, I guess it amplifies all emotions, right? In many ways, Twitter allows for friendships with people that you wouldn't necessarily have met.
That's how we met.
It can be, exactly, but it can be a dark place. And when I saw you going at it with Leafs fans a couple of weeks ago, I thought to myself, like, that's a battle I don't want to fight. That's and good for you. And maybe my generosity of spirit, you know, like you said, it shines in that moment. And I will pick those battles in other places.
Yeah. Well, and it's just, I got annoyed because I wasn't tweeting at them. I was tweeting to the people who are following me. And they found out about me somehow. And now they won't leave me alone. Mm-hmm. But they don't. It's a joke's on them because they're all on mute.
There it is. And now their team's slumping, unfortunately.
Right.
I know that I definitely have the name of the episode now. Thank you, Veronica, for your insight. Generous of spirit. Great, great name for the episode. But no, I was going to say, if Twitter didn't exist, Veronica, I'm going to put you on the spot. Would your vapid hatred for the Maple Leafs exist as it does right now?
No.
Yeah, probably not. I would say the same thing, honestly. Because, it's like, man,
you were irrelevant to us for so long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
As a team, we hadn't played in the playoffs against them for decades.
I can't imagine a Habs-Leafs playoffs this season. It's very likely to happen. God. And I'm like, oh, God.
I might delete my app.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm like, I don't even know if we should even record that week. You know? It's going to be quite a thing. Unless we beat them in the first round and then the narrative continues. And that would be so, so sweet. And then we lose in the next round. But whatever.
The ratings will be incredible.
The ratings
will be incredible. It'll be the whole, in many ways it will put the whole country on pause. I think that everybody will watch, and that would be would be cool. And like you said, Veronica, it's never happened in my lifetime. The Habs have never played the Leafs in the playoffs, and it would be great to see. And I think one of the reasons that I hate the Bruins is because of all of those years when Cam Neely used to beat us when I was a kid, and I actually used to get upset about these things. I can't dig deep like that and feel that way about Toronto, especially when, you know, I spent so much of my childhood making fun of them for not having won a cup since 67 and realizing that now it's 1993 it's sort of like 67 in a lot of ways. It's as far away from now as 67 was when I was making fun of the Leafs for not having won in 25 years.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I don't know what we have to stand on other than a past that I didn't witness. And I think that might, you know, if you had all of those cups, if you had that dynasty in the 70s, and then you could say, well, you guys haven't won since. And the Leafs, I think they won a few cups in the 60s. I think they did better in than the Habs in the 1960s.
They had quite a team back then.
Didn't they beat Montreal in 67?
I think they did, yeah.
Pardon? Yeah, they beat the Habs. Their last cup, they beat the Habs, yeah. Yeah, they did.
Put some black and white.
But yeah, I think that one was in color, actually. Oh. I think that you can find, I think it was. Okay.
It was before the moon landing.
It's true.
It was during the Cold War. Before or after the Cuban Missile Crisis, just around there was when they got their cup, you know?
Right, right. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, those poor guys.
But no, they're due. And I was happy for the Rangers in 94. I was happy for the Blackhawks when they finally did it too. Mm-hmm. And it's about the fan bases, and it's about getting that feeling. And I'm so lucky that I got to experience that and I got to see it. I have these, you know, my memories are a little fuzzy from that game in 93, but when they won and they all jumped on Patrick and started celebrating, it was on the opposite end of the rink. I was sitting in the Reds with my dad. We were about 10 rows up in the corner, but we were on the wrong side of the ice for the celebration. And I remember at one point, Stefan LeBeau realized that there was this whole other half of the Forum that he could go celebrate with. And he just skated over to our side and the place just went nuts. To bring it full circle to those Forum days, so much of it is equated with success. And of course, when you're young, it puts a veneer on everything too, and makes it so much more special because, you know, there's the passage of time. But in many ways, the Forum helped me grow up. I mean, it was a building that meant so much to me. I remember it was accessible in a way that it isn't now. If you want to go to a hockey game now, and let's.
Oh, you're frozen.
Oh, yep. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
This was going to be a very good little segment, too. I can just imagine.
Oh, shit. Oh, I lost you. There, you're back now. You're back.
Okay.
Good.
All right.
Phew. I was like, how long was I talking? Where did I get cut out?
The Forum is accessible in a way that isn't now.
That isn't today, just financially.
Yeah.
So I remember being able to like go on a date when I was in grade eight and go to the Faubourg to an afternoon movie and then walk down the street to the Forum, pay $10 for standing room. And that's a world that doesn't exist anymore.
No. Mm-hmm.
And that just makes it feel so, so special. And I don't know if a 12-year-old kid today has that. I genuinely don't know. I can't put myself in those shoes.
Yeah.
But I know that at the time it felt special. I was, you know, being in that building was an incredible feeling. And it all just seemed larger than life at the time. And maybe for you, maybe for your listeners, it still has that appeal. It doesn't for me. I wish it did because it brought me so much joy.
But you're still watching the games.
Not every game. No. Not as frequently. I know. Last night I mentioned to my girlfriend that I was going to be doing this. She's like, oh, you better watch the game tonight. They might quiz you.
No. They won. That's what we care about now.
That's right. That's right.
It was a great game.
It was a great game. I had season tickets from when the Expos left until 2012 or 2013. And the price in that time, the price of the ticket just about tripled. And I just thought it's not worth it for me. It was at $30. It was worth it to sit in the grays at $100 plus wanting another, you know, couple of grand for a playoff deposit for something that that they then want to roll over and I'm probably not going to see again. A little tougher of a sell.
That is a problem.
But it's a problem. It's that accessibility is, it just makes it harder. It just makes it harder to turn people on in the same way that playing hockey isn't as accessible for young kids anymore just because it's so expensive because the winter, the outdoor rink season is so much shorter. So it changes who can participate and it makes it more of an elitist pursuit, which it definitely wasn't when I was a kid.
No. Mm-hmm. We had to talk about this a few weeks ago, didn't we, Dave, about how golfing, downhill skiing, hockey, those are all sports that you have to be financially set if you're going to pursue it as a, you know, as a dream or a career. And it's just like, I couldn't do that for my son.
Yeah. I know.
Right.
Yep. When I was a kid, growing up with my grandpa in the woods in upstate New York, we weren't playing hockey, but I played soccer with my mom, you know, and I grew up playing soccer. And it wasn't until I had a career where I said, you know what, I want to try skating and playing hockey. And 5 years ago, wow. I gear up, join an adult league, and, you know, I play whenever I can now. So it's definitely
good for you.
It's too bad. And yeah, thanks. No, it was a cool step. I run their website.
What's the name of the team again?
The Rensselaer Rejects.
The Rejects.
Just the best. There was a bunch of adult leagues around.
I've seen Rensselaer on the highway.
Yeah.
I've seen that highway sign it's for
there.
Rensselaer.
It's there. Yeah. It's there. But yeah, all the adult leagues, cool. You know, have pretty much established players. And you'd go to a stick and puck at a rink. And essentially, the guy that started the team just saw guys that were standing by themselves. They're like, hey, you want to be on a team? Didn't matter skill, nothing. Just how old you were, didn't matter. You want to be on a team, here you go. And now we have like, Jesus, 100, 150 people that are in and out, you know, playing games with us and whatnot. So it's really cool. So, trying.
Could I give you guys a good story about accessibility?
I yes. would.
Being a kid.
Because you are being, number one, generous of spirit and generous of time. We are at our hour. But this sounds like a good conclusion.
Yeah, please.
I think maybe. So please.
Maybe. You can be the judge. If it's not, then we'll find something else to end on.
Okay.
So again, early 1990s, and maybe you could help me out with the dates here. But I managed to get tickets to the Junior All-Star Game. So it was the QMJHL. Versus the WHL and OHL All-Stars. And on the QMJHL team was Alexandre Daigle. And on the OHL All-Star team, OHLW was Eric Lindros. And Eric Lindros' first appearance at the Montreal Forum. And it was, I mean, I'd say it was a big deal, but truthfully, the building was like a third full. But I remember it feeling like a big deal for me. And I remember the I'm sure you guys remember too, the hype around Lindros.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
When he was coming up and playing for the Oshawa Generals, and everybody thought that he was the next Gretzky, and everybody said that Alexandre Daigle was going to score a bajillion goals in the NHL. And it was a moment. And I wanted to be there. I wanted to see it. And the ticket might have been $5, might have been $10. It was nothing. And I went with a neighbor of mine. And I remember at one point walking through one of the corridors and seeing John Sleeney. Do either of you remember that guy? Remember that name?
Sweeney?
Sleeney, S-L-A-N-E-Y.
No.
He scored the game-winning goal for Canada in, if it wasn't the first World Junior tournament that everybody gave a damn about, then it was at least the first juniors tournament that I gave a damn about. It was in Saskatoon and they beat Russia. I think it was like Kent Manderville and Pat Falloon era World Junior team. And John Sleeney beat the commies. He scored a slap shot and beat the Russians. And it was the USSR at the time. And when I saw him, he had just been drafted, I think, by the Capitals. And I was so excited to see this guy. And he was so thrilled to be recognized. He ended up having a great career in the AHL. And I think when he retired, he was the all-time leading defensive scorer in AHL history. Wow. But I remember just thinking it was so cool in this moment to meet this, you know, Canadian hero that I would walk by 1,000 times now, but somewhere I still have that puck and I was really excited. And one of the cool things about the forum, which I'm guessing you guys were able to gather from when you went on last year on the tour before COVID hit, when you walked into the forum, you were at ice level. Mm-hmm. So
yeah.
There were times if they didn't close the curtains that led from the hallway to the rink, you could actually see players skating by from outside of the building when you stood on Atwater Avenue.
Oh,
and
cool.
if you knew where to walk, you could walk past the Habs dressing room. You could walk through all these tunnels and see where the refs were and see where the Zamboni was. And I was taught at a very young age that as long as you acted like you knew where you were going, chances are people weren't going to stop you. And that has always served me well. If we can leave you with anything, kids, any youngers listening today, just act like you've been there. It will serve you so well through your days, I promise you. And at the time, Patrick Waugh was injured. He was out. He had broken his leg. I think it was in a game against the Maple Leafs, but he had broken his leg. He was wearing a cast. And I walk by, I'm with my buddy Phil, and we walk by this door, and standing on the inside of the door is Patrick Waugh. And I'm a kid. I lose my mind. There's Patrick Waugh. He's standing there, and I probably screeched or squealed or something. And he looked at me and he opened the door and he brought my buddy Phil and I into the Habs dressing room.
Ooh.
And I said to him, I'd ask for your autograph if I had something for you to sign.
Oh,
and
my God.
He grabs a puck.
Oh.
And he signs it for me. And he signs it in a gold pen. And I rub my hand across it.
Oh.
And go,
oh,
no. Wow, and smudge the entire thing. And he takes it and he starts to laugh, takes the puck back from me, and signs the other side.
Oh,
that's so great. God. How awesome. Wow.
So I have this, like, and I mean, you can see it literally, it looks like he signed it drunk on one side and sober on the other. It's
That's awesome.
But that's my Patrick Waugh moment, and it happened in the Montreal Canadiens dressing room. And that was a really special one.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I don't think that level of accessibility exists if you're just some nobody and don't, you know, now I'm sure there are plenty of kids who have a meet and greet with Carey Price at the Bell Center. But it's not because they turned left down a hallway and strutted past the dressing room.
Exactly.
So that's you know, one of many. As I think about it, there was a time when I was standing outside for autographs, and Kevin Haller, who was I believe he was a defenseman with the team in the mid 90s, invited me and my buddy in to watch practice.
Oh man!
And wow. He just said, if anybody bugs you, tell them you're my cousin. So an usher comes up to us and they're like, what are you doing here? And I was like, well, Kevin Haller's my cousin. He invited us in to watch the practice. And I guess an usher was like, well, if he was going to give us a name, and was making it up, he'd probably give us like Carbono.
But right.
Since I picked Kevin Haller.
That's true. Exactly.
Oh, that's right. Awesome.
So yeah, just a lifetime of wonderful memories. And it's crazy that building closed when I was 15.
Yeah.
And yet I'm 40 years old. So I've had 25 years at the other place. And it doesn't compare. Mm-hmm. No. So I feel so fortunate to have that. And you can see behind me here is my Forum seat. It was my 16th. Birthday present from my mom and dad.
Oh.
And is my prized. And I can't wait for the Habs to make a run, and I can do what I do every year when I'm not at the games, which is pull the seat out, bring it near the television, and watch the playoff games while sitting in the Forum seat.
Perfect.
That's what I do too. I watch the playoffs if the Habs are in it on my Forum seat.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a blue one.
Where's your seat? Nice.
Right now it's in storage. Nice. Because I don't have the space to have it permanently displayed, but I only sit in it during playoff games.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That is awesome. Good job, guys. That's great. Mr. Kaufman.
That went by fast.
Yeah, it did. It did. It went by super fast. I realized, like, oh my God, where's the timer at? And then I looked at it, I'm like, oh, we're out.
We didn't even get into concerts at the Forum. They're just a whole other part of
you
it.
You mentioned Oshaga, and I'm like, I'm in a group chat with a bunch of Habs fans that are saying, hey, if the border's open, we're getting together for Oshaga, and we're just going party. And plus, it's the Foo Fighters. Like, holy cow.
Oh my God.
I know.
I love them so much.
So great. So hoping that all works out.
Having seen, I didn't get to a ton of concerts at the Forum, but I, I saw Rod Stewart there, and I saw Eric Clapton, and I saw REM on the Monster Tour, and the Hip at the concert that that I alluded to it on Twitter last week, but that Tragically Hip concert in 1995 changed my life and gave me a lifelong love affair for the Tragically Hip that will never go away. And that was an incredible night. They there used to be urban legends of the players in the 70s stepping on the ice after the night after a big concert and just breathing deep and breathing in all the weed smoke. I can tell you for certainty that without smoking a joint that night at the Forum in February of 1995, I was high as a kite from the hot box that building turned into.
That's great. Awesome.
And on that professional note,
yeah, we gotta go now. Thank you, Mr. Kaufman. No, that was awesome. Thank you so much for coming on, and I guess we'll start our fade out now. Yeah. So goodbye, listeners. Thank you all so much.
And watchers, viewers,
and watchers and viewers. Remember, hit the like button and the subscribe button, and and also follow Dave Kaufman at the Kaufman Show.
Correct.
At the Kaufman Show on Twitter.
He's generous of spirit.
Generous of spirit and time. Thank you, guys. So yeah, we'll start the fade out now. I don't know if you have to.